What I'm going to do to you today is I really want you to understand the therapeutics of lupus, because I think people who understand what's happening do better. As a matter of fact, there are good studies to show that people who understand their condition do better than people who don't want to know anything about their condition. So today, I'm going to take you through a little bit of an odyssey here, the same way I take the medical students and the rheumatology residents. I'll bring it to the language so that we all understand, but you're all going to get the same program here. Okay, so I want you to understand the therapeutics that you're all taking and where we are. And more important, I want to show you where we hope we're going to be going in the not too distant future. Okay, so remember, along the way, since I told you I'm giving you first, second year medicine and third year medicine topics today. So stop me anywhere along the line if you want me to elaborate. So first, let me show you.
Pardon? Oh, is it working?
Yeah. Good. I'm going to talk to you, first of all, on what we believe currently the cause of lupus is. That's what pathogenesis means, how lupus occurs. And in order for you to understand the treatment of lupus, you have to understand what is lupus, what's happening within your bodies, okay? So that's the first step. Then I'm going to talk to you about the therapies that you all have been exposed to or are being exposed to now. That's the current state of therapeutics. And then I want to talk to you about the newer approaches and where things are going. Okay, so those are the three approaches that we're going to be taking today. So the first one is, let me show you what lupus is, okay? So this is, as I told you, second year medicine. The problem with a patient with lupus is that she or he make too many autoantibodies. Now, what is that? So an antibody is what your body produces when it is exposed to a foreign agent. So if your body sees a germ, a bacteria, it makes an antibody, that's a protein in the body, against that germ, which then combines with the germ and gets rid of the germ. Okay? So that's what an antibody is. An autoantibody means that your body is making an antibody against parts of yourself, not of something that's coming in from the outside. Okay? So you're making antibodies against part of your own tissues, parts of your own body. So what does that mean? Well, when the body makes antibodies against itself, two things happen. I'm sorry, if I'm in your way, just go like this and I'll know I'm in your way, so I'll move over. So two things happen. The first thing is, some of these antibodies are actually attacking some of your own cells, just like it would attack a foreign substance, and damage those cells. So some of you, you know, have had low hemoglobin, low red blood cells. Some have had low platelets, right? So that's because the body has made an antibody against your red blood cells and caused them to be destroyed. Or your body has made antibodies against your platelets, caused them to be destroyed, and then that will predispose to bleeding and things like that. So that's what one set of antibodies does. It actually attacks tissues and damages those tissues. Another action of this antibody is that it may combine with whatever tissue that's been released in your own body. It may combine with it to form a complex, to form a union like this. So let me tell you that, and I'm going to show you later how this why this happens. Your body sometime will release your own DNA into the circulation, because cells will be damaged and DNA will be released. And the body will say, oh, I'm going to make antibodies against that DNA. So it makes an antibody against DNA. So you've got DNA, anti-DNA, forming a complex like this. That complex then circulates around in the body, and it deposits itself in different parts of the body. If it deposits itself in the skin, as soon as it sits in the skin, it causes a little fire to explode. And therefore you get a rash, so you get dermatitis. If this complex settled itself in the kidney, you get nephritis. right? So that's with lupus nephritis. So wherever this complex settles itself, as soon as it's settled down, it stimulates functions in the body that cause a little fire. And that part of the body then becomes inflamed. So those are the two ways that damage occurs in the body. One, an antibody can go in and damage a cell, that's on your left, or it can combine with the antigen to form a complex, circulate around in the body and deposit itself somewhere and cause a little fire, right? So there are two ways that lupus patients may have medical problems from those two methods. Okay, so the question, so it's you know, you're making antibodies, not a good thing, and this is what the antibodies do. Now, here is actually a picture of the kidney. This is a kidney biopsy, and you'll see all these little bumpy things, these little bumpy deposits. This is on the basal membrane of the kidney, little lumpy deposits. Every one of those lumps is DNA, anti-DNA, sitting there, causing a fire. So you can actually show that. When they're doing a kidney biopsy, that's what they're looking for. Am I finding these kind of deposits in the kidney? All right. So then the question is, well, why do you make these antibodies? Like, most of us don't make antibodies like that. Why do you do that? So in the normal body immune mechanisms, if you make some antibody that's inappropriate, the body has another process. It says, look, that's not correct, stop. And it shuts off the antibody. As a matter of fact, if you have a germ come in and the body makes an antibody against the germ, it makes an antibody for a week or 5 days, and then the germ is gone. And so the body has to make another signal to say, okay, the germ's gone, stop making the antibody, right? And the same thing, if the body happened to make an antibody against itself, the body has another mechanism, the immune system has another mechanism to say, stop, that's inappropriate. In lupus, that shut-off mechanism isn't working well. So you see, I've shown you here, there are certain cells in your body called T suppressor cells, which are supposed to suppress, stop the immune reaction when it's inappropriate. You see it's blocked here. It doesn't stop the body from making autoantibodies. So the shutoff mechanism isn't working normally. Okay, got it so far? Makes too many antibodies, the shutoff mechanism isn't working normally. That's not the whole story. A woman with lupus or a man with lupus makes too many autoantibodies. Why? There are at least four reasons. First of all, you're born with that predisposition. There's a genetic component. So for instance, lupus occurs in one in every thousand people in the population, more or less, right? One in every thousand people. In family members, parents, children, brothers and sisters, it's about one in 12. Not one in 1,000, one in 12. So it seems to run in families. Now, the bad news is it runs in families. 1 in 12 will get it. The good news is 11 out of 12 relatives won't get it. So, you know, you've got to think of it as the glass half full, okay? So think of it that way, right? Yes, there's a greater predisposition, but, you know, the chances are hopefully that it won't happen. All right, so first of all, we're doing, and we know, for instance, that twins, identical twins, there's a very high concordance that when one twin gets it, the other twin gets it. And we also have some genetic markers. You may have heard the word HLA is a genetic marker. That genetic marker shows that people with lupus have a similar genetic marker. So there are a lot of ways that we know that this has a genetic component. The exact genetics are not known. There's a lot of genetic work being done. So far, there are 36 genes that are associated with lupus. So you have to get a lot of genes from your parents all to come together to have that predisposition. But there is a predisposition. The second thing is the environment. Now, you all know the environment is important because you've all been told to stay out of the sun. So we know that sun can aggravate lupus. You've probably also heard that lupus can be brought on by some drugs, right? So there is a drug-induced lupus. So there are things in the environment, whether it's drugs, sun, virus infections, or other things that we don't know about yet, that can also contribute to bringing this on, okay? The third thing is, there seems to be a woman component here. You know, this is 9 or 10 to 1 women versus men, right? It may not be women, it may be estrogen hormone, supposedly the female hormone. Now listen, estrogen is produced by men and women, but women have more of it, right? And it does different things in women. Men metabolize the estrogen, break it down, and get rid of it, okay? Men with lupus seem not to be able to break down the estrogen the same way as other men do. So they have more estrogen in their system. They're men, they're XY, that means their chromosomes are appropriately men, they can have children, it's not a problem, but they don't handle estrogen well. So estrogen hormone tends to be an important thing, and you know that lupus occurs for the first time generally in the childbearing era, you know, in the women when they're in their teens, 20s, and 30s, and early 40s. That's the time when lupus begins, and that's the highest estrogen time in your life. So we know estrogen is important, okay? And then there are a lot of other things. Did your parents always say to you, don't go in the cold, your resistance will break down and you'll get sick, or something like that? Well, your parents are probably right. There's a lot of research now indicating that people under significant stress, their immune system doesn't work normally. It breaks down. And patients will often say, this all started when my child left home, or I had, unfortunately, had a breakup in my marriage. In other words, they relate it to some stressful situation. And we think that that at least plays a role, and the whole field of psychoimmunology, how the brain affects the immune system, is now being studied, okay? So look, what I've done here now, you finished second year medicine. This is the pathogenesis of lupus. So very simply now, do woman or man with lupus make too many autoantibodies, antibodies against themselves? Those autoantibodies cause damage in two different ways. They either damage the cell directly, or they form this complex which goes around the body and starts fires. Okay? And then why does she do that or he do that? Because they don't have a normal shut-off mechanism. They don't stop making these autoantibodies when they should. And why do they make these autoantibodies? I've given you at least four different reasons here. So this is the pathogenesis of lupus, the cause of lupus. We don't know why she makes all those, you know, we don't know for sure what triggers this whole thing, but this is how it evolves and how it occurs. Is that clear? We okay? Great. This is better than the medical students. They all right, so the second thing is, so how do we, let's talk about treatment. Now, I'm not going to talk to you about today's treatment in great detail because you're all involved with that and your doctors have told you, but generally speaking, I'm not going to talk about cortisone for that today. I'm fighting back, I'll do that later. cortisone today, because you all know you've all taken prednisone for periods of time, and we tried to do that for as little time, as low a dose and as short a time as possible, right, with the prednisone. You all know that you've all been told you must take anti-malarials, Plaquenil, right? All the time. That's sine qua non. You must do that. All of us should be on that drug. It's a very important drug for us, right? So that's prednisone and Plaquenil. The next group of drugs are called the immunosuppressive drugs or the cytotoxic drugs. Now, what are these? So this was the theory. The theory was if we're making too many autoantibodies, let's get rid of the body cells that are making these autoantibodies, right? We don't want to shut them off yet, but well, let's get rid of the cells that's making them. And that's what These drugs do. Cyclophosphamide, azathioprine, which is Imuran, MMF, which is Celcept or Myfortec, and methotrexate. These drugs, these are like atom bombs. They go in and they wipe out cells, okay? And you hope that the cells that they're wiping out mostly are the cells that are making these autoantibodies. But in the process, you always wipe out some good cells. So you know when you're taking these drugs, you always have to have blood counts to make sure your good cells aren't going down too far, right? And sometimes, if your good cells do go down too far, you have to stop the drug or to lower the dose of the drug, okay? So our approach, until very recently, has been primarily to use these drugs which knock out the cells making these abnormal antibodies. Has this been good treatment? It's been fantastic treatment. When I started, the 5-year survival, I'm not saying how well-being, I'm talking about survival. The 5-year survival was about 60%. Now, the 5-year survival is about 95% or 98%. The 20-year survival in our cohort is now 90%. So have these drugs worked? Obviously they've worked. Look how much better people are doing today with lupus, right? So they have worked, but at a cost, right? In other words, they've caused some problems, these drugs. In some people, a little problem. In some people, a lot of problem, right? So that's why there's always the look for other drugs. And then, of course, you know, these drugs, we're talking in large part about women in their childbearing era. Women would like to have children. And by the way, with lupus, if your lupus is quiet when you go into pregnancy, you can have children. I have about 420 godchildren. I have pictures on my wall of women with lupus who have had children. However, you can't take all of these drugs when you want to get pregnant. So you certainly can't take cyclophosphamide, you can't take Celcept, you probably shouldn't take methotrexate. Azathioprine or Imuran is perfectly safe during pregnancy. You can take it throughout the whole pregnancy and nothing happens to the child, nothing happens to the mother. So even if some of our patients are on these other drugs and they want to become pregnant, we switch them to Imuran and they can become pregnant then, okay? So that's the current state of affairs. All right, you can take a deep breath. Okay, now we're going to talk about today. Where are we and where do we hope we're going to be going? So I'm sorry, I wish the screen were bigger, but this is immunology, third year medicine. So bear with me, this is very important. Can you see the screen from here? You okay? So let me show you how this works. In your body, for some reason, some of your cells break down and they release their internal substance. Well, all cells break down. No cell lives forever. Some of our cells live over 7 days and die. And when they die, they break down and the body comes along, gets rid of the breakdown products, and everything's fine, right? In a patient with lupus, sometime when cells break down and release their substances, like what's the inside of a cell got? DNA, right? So it releases DNA into the circulation. So what happens ordinarily? The scavenger cells in the body sends out its scavenger cells, right? And it says, get rid of that DNA. So it picks up this DNA that's floating around here, and it's going to go and get rid of it. Well, how does it get rid of it? You've got to get some antibody. Remember I told you the antibodies have to come along, get that DNA, and then get it out of your system. Well, how are the cells going to know that they got to come along and get rid of this anti-DNA? And this is where the complicated immunology occurs. So bear with me now. This is very important. Here you've got the DNA broken down, and the scavenger cell picks it up, and it's going to take it to the immune system. It goes to the immune system, which are generally comprised of two kinds of lymphocytes. You've heard this, the T cells and the B cells, right? The T cells and the B cells. So first the scavenger cell brings this DNA to the T cell. This is the central cell in the immune system. And this scavenger cell wants to say to the T cell, get the process going to get rid of this stuff. Right? So how does it do that? So this cell, the scavenger cell, talks to this T cell in a very complicated way. Now, stay with me now, okay? What does it do? This scavenger cell has, and I'm sorry this is so small, so you can see that, right in the middle thing here, it has that DNA, and it carries it over to this T cell, and it attaches itself to a receptor on the T cell, and it says, here's DNA, get working to get rid of this. Well, if that was all it would do, that's easy, right? Here it is, go get rid of it. It's not quite so simple because the scavenger cell doesn't speak straight English. It doesn't immediately tell the T cell what to do. It just says, hey, T cell, here's some DNA. For the T cell to recognize this DNA, it has to have two other signals. So, let me give you an example you'll understand. When you want your car to start, you put the key in. Car didn't start. So, the car knows, because the light goes on the dashboard, the car knows the key's in the ignition, but it won't start. If you turn it halfway, you'll hear the radio, but the motor won't go on yet, right? So that's the second signal. You've put it in, signal one. You've turned it halfway, signal two. Nothing's happening yet. Then you cook it hard all the way, and the motor goes on. So to start a car, you needed three signals. And that's what happens with the scavenger cell and the T cell. It needs three signals. So just having this cell show the T cell the DNA is not enough. It needs a signal here and a signal here. Okay? And when you have all three signals there, then the T cell says, aha, I see DNA, and I know I have to get rid of it. Okay? So let me show you the example here. Just look on the left of the slide, if you can see it. That red is the DNA, and it's showing the DNA to this T cell. And here's the first signal up on top, the second signal, and here's the third signal down here, right? And when all three signals are there, the cells talk to each other, and they start the process in the immune system to get rid of the DNA. Are you with me? Okay. So, here we are, three cells, right? And three signals, and the T cell's ready. Now, what if we said, wait a minute, if we don't want the body to make these antibodies, why don't we interrupt this signal? Why don't we garble their talking? Why don't we stop this signal or this signal so that the whole immune process of making antibodies will stop? Now think how different that is. In the first instance, you're taking a drug that wipes out all cells. In this instance, if we have a drug, and I'll show you in a moment, if we have a drug, it's just stopping this talking. No cell dies. All the cells are still there. But they don't talk to each other as well. Okay? So that's an approach. And one drug, don't worry about the writing, one drug which you may have heard of is a drug called abatacept, which does exactly that. What does it do? Look, it gets to this signal here, and you make an antibody against this part of the signal. You see the antibody against the signal? Can you see that here? Oh, sorry. Can you see what had happened here? This antibody comes in, a different antibody comes in, blocks the bottom of this signal here, and now this is no longer talking to that. Can you see that? That was a drug called abatacept. And we were very excited by that, right? We said, this is great. You're not killing any cells. You're just stopping the talk a little bit, and so they won't make so many antibodies. Unfortunately, and you may be hearing this recurrently this morning, a trial was done with that, and it was not successful. But it was a bad trial. And if you want to know what about good trials and bad trials, that's the second visit when you invite me. So take it from me, it was not a good trial. And there's currently a new trial with this drug that I'm involved in, right? That's currently underway, and we're very hopeful about this drug. And by the way, even though the drug didn't work here in this first trial, there were virtually no side effects, right? So if the new trial that's currently underway, if it's successful, that would be very helpful. A drug that works on only one little part of the immune system without killing other cells, right? And has a very few side effects. So you've got the idea now how we're tickling the immune system. We're not killing it, right? As one example. All right, so now, if this talk all goes well, and this cell talks, the scavenger cell talks to the T cells, and everything is good, the T cell then gears up, right? And it can do two things. It can take the and this DNA and take it to the antibody factory. What's the antibody factory? The B cell. Remember we said there are T cells and B cells? The factory is where the antibodies are made. That's the B cell. So if the talk has been successful, then one thing that can happen is this T cell can talk to the factory and say, make antibodies. Right? Now, making the antibodies may not be a great thing here, but we're hoping that it's going to eliminate the DNA, if it does. The other thing that can happen if the talk went well is that the T cell, instead of making antibodies, can actually become a T cell which shuts off antibodies. Remember I told you that the lupus patient doesn't have the shut-off mechanism, right? So you can make a T cell which actually shuts off this process, right? And so, remember I showed it to you here? This shut-off mechanism isn't working in lupus patients because when that talk occurs between the scavenger and the T cell, it doesn't hear that it should shut off. So it doesn't work well. Well, there was a drug called Edretai, just the title, which actually causes the T cells to be those T cells which shut off the immune system. Isn't that a wonderful thing? We're taking a cell and we're not making those antibodies that we don't want. We're not killing the cell. We're just making more of the shut-off cells. That's exactly what we want. This was one of the first studies done in lupus with this drug. I was very involved in that study, and that was well before we knew how to do good studies in lupus, because lupus is a very complicated illness, you know? It's not like rheumatoid arthritis where, and I don't minimize rheumatoid arthritis, but rheumatoid arthritis is a condition where you have tender joints. In lupus, you can have joints, skin, kidney, lung, brain, I mean, it could be anything. So it's much more complicated than rheumatoid arthritis, right? So it was an era, this is probably 15, 20, 18 years ago, where we weren't really good at doing studies. And so unfortunately, again, this drug didn't show to be helpful, again, had no side effects. People were so distressed by that and looked at the study that now that drug has been revived. And a new study is now underway with the better way of doing studies to hopefully demonstrate, yes, that lupus patients can get better. There weren't side effects with this drug, and if we can show it's helpful, it would be spectacular because what it's doing is it's correcting the problem. The problem is no shutoff mechanism, right? This gives you a good shutoff mechanism. So don't get discouraged. You're hearing stories, oh, that drug didn't work even though it should have worked, this drug didn't work even though it should have worked. And that's not so much a factor of the drugs as is how we did the study, right? So we're hoping that now that we know how to do studies correctly, that we're going to show that both of those drugs work. You got a question?
I was just wondering, are they, the two that you already mentioned, are they both used, or all kinds of lupus, like
yes.
all severities?
Yes, so that's a wonderful question. So the question is, and you've actually nailed why some of the studies were bad, the old studies. The reason is, when you put a patient with lupus into a study, we say, come all ye faithful. You know, any lupus patient wants to be in the study. But one patient may have skin, one patient may have joints, one patient may have pleurisy. So we're having patients with all kinds of different things. And why do we think that one drug might help all? Mm-hmm. You know, so we have to look carefully, and this is how we're fixing our studies now. We're not taking every lupus, you know, mixtures of lupus, but we're trying to take lupus patients who have similar kinds of problems, because the drug may work for some problems, but not other problems. You all know, if you have high blood pressure, some people take one drug, some take two drugs, some people take two drugs, but two different drugs, so each body responds differently, right? So it may be that one kind of lupus responds to one drug, and another kind responds to another drug. And it may be in the future, you know, that people with lupus will be taking two drugs, right? Just like people with high blood pressure or diabetes or malignancy take two or three drugs. They don't take one drug. So we're looking for drugs that will work here that won't be toxic, right? That won't be too harmful to the body. So this was the second drug. And again, the ones that I said didn't work, both of them are now currently in trials. And you know what? When I say a drug is in trial, do you know what that means? To take a drug from inception, where you test it in animals, then in humans, then you do a phase one study, phase two, phase three. You know what the cost of that is? $100 million. To take a drug from nothing to the end. Now, these drugs already have had their studies in animals and studies in humans. They're only entering into the last phase of the studies in patients with lupus, so that may be about $50 million. So when I hear a company is, yes, ready to start doing these two drugs again at $50 million, right, I'm delighted because it's a commitment, right, and they're going to obviously want to try to do this well. Okay, so that's the other drug. Now, once you get, if the T cell picks up the DNA and it takes it to the DNA factory, the B cell, saying to the B cell, okay, start making antibodies and get rid of this substance, right? So the B cell starts to work and it makes these antibodies. So some allergist came along and said, wait a minute. Maybe the lupus patient problem is they're kind of like allergic to DNA. To the antibodies, right? To DNA itself, right? And the antibodies. And so why don't we do like we do for allergies? Why don't we give you shots, immunization, you know? And if you start with very low, like hay fever, right? You start with very low injections of hay fever, and you'd give the young people come in and get their shots every week, and at the end of a year or two, they're no longer allergic to hay fever pollen. Okay, so the theory was, well, what if we make antibodies against this DNA, and this anti-DNA here, and if we inject a little bit of this into a patient, will they eventually become allergic, and so now the DNA won't bother them anymore. And that study was actually done, by the way, I didn't think it was a wise study. I just want to tell you that the first two I thought were really wise studies, this one. Not such a wise study. So there was a drug, and then you see it doesn't even have a name. It still has a number. Why? Because this drug was not successful and never made the market. But I just wanted to show you, you know, what the approaches that have been taken. So now you see what I've left for last. I left the best for last. That is the factory. This factory that's making these antibodies to DNA, which are causing all of our problems, right? The DNA and anti-DNA antibodies, the B cell. So if we can sort of decrease the amount of B cells or stop them from working so well without killing them, we don't want to kill them. We want those B cells around to make antibodies against flu and against pneumonia and things like that. We don't want them to go away. But if we can dampen them down, especially dampen down the ones that are making the anti-DNA antibodies, that would be a good thing. So much of the recent activity has been directed at the B cell, the factory. Okay? Now, on the surface of the B cell, there are all kinds of little markers. You know, one house is painted red, one is yellow, one is brown. It distinguishes one site from the next site. So there are a lot of different sites on the surface of these lymphocytes. They go by the name CD20, CD22, etc. So they all have numbers, but what they are identifying marks on the surface of the B cell. So if we could somehow say, oh, I know that identifying mark, why don't I make something, an antibody against those identifying marks, which will neutralize that cell, because now it's going to have something sitting on top of it and it won't do any bad things, right? So we're looking for substances that attach itself to the surface of the B cell factory and stop it from working well, okay? Yes?
Sorry. So we don't know, like, researchers don't know which of the different
markers
is the one that needs to be treated, like...
Right. No, it may not be... It could be any. If any of the markers stop the factory from working, we don't care which marker it is, right? So it could be one of a lot of markers. It's got to be something which says, oh, here this intact B cell working so wonderfully now can't work because it's got something that's clogging its machinery. Right? So that's the way to get at those cells. So the first one, which you may have heard of, and some of you may have had, is Rituxan or rituximab. It's an injection, and it is an anti-CD20. Remember, I told you it's a marker. You know, just remember the name. Don't worry about what comes underneath. It's an anti-CD20, so it is directed against one of those markers on the B cell, right? And you get it by injection, two injections 2 weeks apart. And it knocks out the B cells. Does it work? Whoa! Does it ever decrease those B cells? It stops the factory cold. So, here's a wonderful example of how we are bad at studies. Let me tell you, there has been a number of studies. This study called Lunar because it was lupus nephritis, okay? And it showed no effect. No different than people who got water by injection, okay? And here was a second one called the Explorer, which was not lupus, was lupus patients without kidney disease. And again, no effect, no difference from water. Now, how do I know these were bad studies? Because this is a very commonly used drug today. We're using it, and it works. And how do we know, how can we get it? If it didn't work, how did the FDA or Health Canada, how did they pass it? So don't tell anybody, but this drug is available for other reasons. It's used as one of the drugs that treats lymphoma. So the oncology people, the cancer people have this drug. So we can all use it, right? So even though the studies themselves weren't very good and didn't show any effect, it is a very commonly used drug around the world. So here is a new drug now, not yet formally approved, but available to us, right? And it shuts off this B cell factory, and they stop making antibodies, and we can show that the antibody levels fall dramatically, right? And the B cells go down, especially the B cells making those bad anti-DNA antibodies. So here's a drug that is logical in the way of our thinking, makes sense, it should work, and despite the studies, right, does work, okay? So that's actually encouraging. All right, so now, what about other areas on the B cell, right? We have a drug called eprituzumab, which is instead of CD20, it's against CD22. See, it doesn't matter what you're aiming at. You're just aiming at something on the surface of the B cells. This was a heartbreak story. This is beginning to sound repetitive, isn't it? This was a heartbreak story. Here was a drug against CD22. And in the phase 2, the drugs go through phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 is the one where the finally the accrediting bodies, the FDA and Health Canada, look at. But in the phase two study, it was so positive that people couldn't understand, you know, was so excited by it, and immediately went into phase three study. And the phase three study had almost 2,000 patients in it. And there were two halves of the study, about 1,000, and one half, 1,000, the other half. One of the studies was positive, and one was negative. And we all said, I sat on that review committee when we first reported the results of the studies. We said to the company, the doctors, look, there's a strong signal here. This second study also, even though it wasn't positive, had a signal. We're excited. You need to do more work here. And the company said, but we've already spent $100 million. And on the chance that this is not going to be positive, even though one was positive, one was negative, they dropped it. And so this drug, even though it was so exciting early on and has certainly had a signal in the phase three trials, has not been pursued. So someone would say, well, somebody else should pick it up. But someone else picking it up means $50 million, right? So whether this will be picked up again in the future or not, I'm not sure. But we've seen signals with that drug, and we're greatly disappointed that people have dropped it. And you see, dropping, if continuing on a drug was based solely on what it looked like and how it was doing, it would be wonderful. Unfortunately, it's based on, is somebody willing to put up the money to do the studies? And that's one of our great drawbacks, our downfalls, right? All right, so what about any other studies on this B-cell factory, which is where we want to go? Here's a good news story. Okay, here's a good news story. So, in the normal immune system, that B cell doesn't exist in isolation. The B cell has to be stimulated, has to have the workers, has to have the factory, has to have all the things that make it work, right? So there are B cell stimulating factors, that are things that make this B cell work very well, okay? That B lymphocyte stimulating factor is called BLYS, B-L-Y-S, right? B cell, B lymphocyte stimulating factor, BLYS, okay? So let me show you what that is. On the surface, here you have so I'll stand back here and see. Here you have the B cell, right? And you've got the markers here ready to get this DNA that's going to be brought to it. And for the B cell to work well, it needs to be stimulated by this BLYS, the little red dots. So BLYS is what makes the B cell factory work. It makes it mature. It makes it able to spew out lots of antibodies. So it makes it grow and work harder, okay? So the theory was, wait a minute, why don't we get rid of that BLYS, that stimulating factor, and now the factory will be there, but it won't be working very well, right? That's a good theory. Why? Because the B cell will still be there. The factory will be there for when we need it in the future, right? But you're taking away the stimulating things, and therefore, it won't work as well. That's a great idea. And that's what Benlysta is, or the chemical name is belimumab, right? And that's the one that's on the market. So let me tell you about that. So with Benlysta is this antibody, this little yellow Y here, which takes all of these stimulators, binds to them, and blocks them, and they no longer can rev up the B cell, right? So the B cell is sitting there saying, well, where's the light, where's the heat, I can't work, right? That's what the BLYS does for it, right? So that drug actually was tested, phase one, phase two, phase three. The phase three had two studies, one in North America, one in Europe and in the Far East, They went for a year or 76 weeks, long studies. And this is the FDA and Health Canada demand that you do a study for a year, which is why, and you're doing 2,000 patients and you're seeing them every month and you're drawing blood work, etc., you can see why it runs up to $100 million, right? So here were the two studies that were done, and they were both, the little yellow orange thing on top means positive. The Bliss 52 was positive, and the Bliss 76 was positive, right? So both studies were positive, and they were passed by the FDA in the United States, passed by Health Canada in Canada, and this drug is on the market. Okay? So the good news is this drug is available. The bad news is that some of the payers are not very helpful. So what do I mean by that? These drugs, all of these new biologic drugs, cost approximately $20,000 a year. Okay? So, you know, we could argue, is that real, is not real? You know, it's all got to do with recouping that $100 million, you know? Anyway, they're very expensive. The good news, virtually every private insurance company covers it. So if you have insurance from your work, the drug will be covered. In Ontario, right, if you are on disability or if you are over 65, both of those things, disability and over 65, Ontario pays for all drugs, but not this one. So I've been to Ottawa and I said, what's going on? You know, in rheumatoid arthritis, there are 7 biologic drugs like this that work for rheumatoid arthritis, and you cover all of them. So how come for lupus, where there's only one drug, you won't cover it, right? And so they say, oh, yeah, that's good. So explain to me why, and I do the same thing as I'm doing here. And they say, oh, yes, that's interesting. And then you get the letter which says, sorry, we're not covering it. So nobody understands what's happening. We continue to lobby. And I don't know what the situation is in Alberta, if it's similar.
I can clarify that.
Yes?
So generally, there isn't coverage, but there is a short-term program where the rheumatologist can fill, or nephrologist can fill out the paperwork, apply to the government, and we've had some patients covered through that program.
That's wonderful. You see that? And I'm going to go back now and say, why can't we do what you've done? That's a wonderful story. And what I want to say is, please stay involved, because I think the thing that's going to turn this around is not me going to Toronto or to Ottawa. It's going to be lobbying from people. You know, government listen to people, not to a single person who crabs all the time. Right? So I think lobbying is very important. If rheumatoid arthritis can have 7 drugs covered, why can't lupus have 1? You know, I think that's a very important issue, and I hope you'll all continue to try and lobby. So this drug then is very important, and it's virtually no side effects. That's the amazing thing, right? Now, does it work for everybody? As I told you before, it may be very good for some people, not as good for other people. It has to do with the person. It has to do with other drugs that you're taking at the same time. So no, it's not the magic pill. But for us, who are involved with lupus, we're delighted to have another pill, or this is an injection, you know, which works. So we're delighted to have this, and you can see that that's working by this Bliss, this stimulating thing here, right, which fires up the B cell, and the B cell is no longer fired up. So that's a that's a good news story. So there you are. That's third meds, right? So we've talked a little bit about what's the cause, how does it occur? Then we talked about, well, how does this immune system work? And the immune system working shows us how we, and the industry, can target parts of the immune system to make them work not so well. In lupus patients, some of the immune system is working too well. You're making antibodies against your own tissue, that's too good, right? So some of these drugs then will help correct that immune system so that you hopefully will stop making the bad antibodies and only continue making the good antibodies. So that's the area that we've covered, and I hope I've sort of clarified it a bit for you, and I'm happy to sit to take some questions, and hopefully there will be, and I'm sure there might be some questions. Do you think people would like to take a short break or go right into questions? What would your preference be?
I think we'll go right into questions.
Great. Fire away. Now, don't ask a personal question. Make it generic, you know, because I can't answer you specifically, but we can talk around a topic and make it a general answer. Yes?
I didn't hear the answer about Alberta, what Alberta does for that drug.
There's a short-term therapy program that your specialist can apply for, so it's quite a bit of paperwork, but we have had rheumatologists apply for funding for the biologics, cetuximab or Benlysta or Cellcept, and get different drug, but those drugs that are very expensive that your insurer may not cover, if your rheumatologist does that paperwork and applies, it can be a very quick process and there will be coverage.
Oh, thank you.
And I can give you details about that.
For how long?
We don't know. So I think we know that people have gotten coverage for a period of time and it's been renewed. There's no guarantee that it will be long term because it's a short term program. So it's not an ideal situation, but it is getting people biologics currently.
If I can just add to what Chris has said, I have our newsletter from last year of 2014, and it does have an article that outlines that program. So if you would like to take one of those for your records, I have a few here at the table.
I just want to think for the H is what our Alberta kind of. So back to what you were talking about.
Yes.
Yeah. They won't cover Benlysta for people like myself. My doctor has applied several times, for example. So is that, is that
so this
normal?
Is a different program that your doctor could apply under?
He has.
Okay,
that's four times.
Yeah, so you know, there's been a lot of reluctance that Benlysta isn't thought to be that effective. And the pharmacists, I think, in Alberta have taken the view that it's not effective, although it's approved.
So can I help? Can I help you talk to the pharmacists now?
Sure.
The Benlysta studies all compared people who are taking everything that we know today: Plaquenil, prednisone, Cellcept, or Imuran. So they're on all these drugs, and they're not doing well. You then take Benlysta, and those same people were not doing well on everything, and they're still on everything. You add Benlysta, and it turns off. Not in everybody, but in some people. But remember, these are people who haven't responded to all of the other drugs put together. So you tell a pharmacist, so what do you want us to do? Keep people on everything that we have today who are not doing well, or take a chance by adding in a new drug which could get them out of this terrible state they're in. And you know, when I first presented to the Ontario drug plan that idea, look, these are people who are refractory to everything we have today. They said, oh, we didn't quite get that. But then they went back to their whatever, and they came back and said, no, and I believe it's all a matter of money. And so I say to them, we'll reallocate some from rheumatoid arthritis. Their argument is, rheumatoid arthritis occurs in 1 out of every 100 people, and lupus occurs in 1 in every 1,000 people. So they say, oh, we got to keep it up for rheumatoid arthritis. And I say, okay, keep it up for rheumatoid arthritis, but with 4 drugs instead of 6 or 7. And put 1 into lupus. You know, when you're dealing with bureaucracy, you don't know who's stopping this, you know, which level is stopping us. If this were all medical people all the way up, there would be no question. Because the medical people have passed it. The FDA and Health Canada have passed it. It's the payers who haven't passed it because they've allocated their money elsewhere, which is where you all come in. You know, public lobbying is extremely important. Yes?
Do No, I was just wondering, when a person has been on all of those medications and they haven't been working, at what point does someone say, maybe this is enough? Like, I don't know how you get from that to getting recommended to something else that hasn't been kind of approved or recommended for them as an individual.
That's what we're talking about, right? In other words, your doctor and you recognize that what's happened isn't enough yet. Mm-hmm. And so we got to keep lobbying. Now, remember I talked to you about rituximab. That's one drug that's available. So you got to get sneaky, go into the hospital, or your doctor goes to the hospital and says, you know, all that drug you've got for lymphoma and things like that, just give us a little, please. And most have been successful with that, right? Because the drug's there.
Yes, right.
Right? But so we got to, those are the kinds of approaches, you know. Now, the first thing is continue. Don't stop what you're doing. You know, what you're doing is holding it. No one should say, oh, this isn't working, I'm stopping it. Because all of these drugs work in part, right? And if you took it away, it would be an explosion. So you don't want to do that. On the other hand, we should be lobbying. You know, we should be pushing. Not only you, but the doctors.
And if I can add, Dr. Clark's just arrived, and she'll be doing the next presentation. And she's the founder of the Lupus Clinic in Alberta. And so she may be able to give us more information about the application for coverage in Alberta than I can.
And there's going to be a test there.
Yeah.
Yes.
About Rituxan.
Yes.
You said that it works.
Yes.
Studies can't show it.
Yes.
So how is that different?
That really is a, how do I explain that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's really a wonderful question. And I've got an hour and a half talk on that. But so let me just give you some key points, right? So the first point I told you already, lupus is not all one disease. You know, maybe, or condition. It may be 10 or 12 conditions. And I gave you examples, you know? So the person who comes in with seizures and fever is different from the seizure. The person who comes in with pleurisy and skin rash is different from the person with arthritis and skin rash, etc. So one of the downfalls is that we have lumped all lupus together, right? So the people who come into trials are a mixed bag. You know, some have this, some have that. So it's very difficult to show that this drug will work against this particular lupus patient, right? Because there aren't enough of this subgroup there for us to tell. So we know now that, you know, in some conditions, like with Rituxan, it's been very, very impressive for kidney disease. So in those other studies, there may not have been enough. Well, I know there weren't enough people with kidney disease because severe kidney disease weren't included in the study. So one thing is, one reason the studies have failed is not all lupus is the same, and in the drug studies, we treat them as if they were all the same. That's one. The second thing is this. I told you that in all the drug studies, the patients who don't get the experimental drug are on a lot of other drugs. They're on prednisone and anti-malarials and one of those drugs like Imuran or Celcept, etc. They're on all of those drugs. Now, the ones who are sick over a year might end up getting a significant amount of prednisone. Now, if they didn't get the new drug, at the end of the year, you say, oh, these guys are better. But why are they better? Because they got prednisone, right? So concomitant therapy, other treatments that people are getting, confuse the situation. What we have got to do is make sure that you don't change anything. You're not doing well, don't change anything. But we're telling you, don't change anything for a year. Remember? So there's a problem there. We've got to figure ways to accelerate that process or to help these people and take into account that they're not better on their own. They're better because they took too much prednisone, etc. See? So that's the second reason. Not all lupus is the same. Treatment isn't well controlled, right? Another reason is that we don't know quite how to say, well, what does better mean? You know, does better mean they got less skin rash, but they didn't get any better in their arthritis, or they got their seizures stopped, but now they got chest pain? Or, in other words, how do we describe better? And in medical terms, that's called a responder index. You know, how did they respond to the treatment? And we are only now, in lupus, learning how to define responder index. Let me give you an example. In rheumatoid arthritis, if we do a study, we say, what's the responder index? How many joints were inflamed before? How many joints are inflamed now? It's easy, relatively easy, right? In lupus, how do we know if somebody got better? Did everything have to go away? Did everything have to be reduced by half? Did one thing go away and not the other? So the responder indices haven't worked out yet, right? So I told you, and this has taken us a number of years, I think we're getting pretty close now to being able to develop design, a good study. But I've given you three examples, you know, as to why the drug trials failed. And some of the drugs may have been better than was actually shown in the studies for those reasons. Yes?
One more question. Do you have any general comments about what drugs you recommend for younger people versus older patients?
Yeah, so I'm glad you made it generic. I don't know if this is someone in your family. So I think the answer is you choose the appropriate therapy for the appropriate person. So what do I don't want to evade the question. There are a number of approaches to lupus. The first thing is you've got to put out the fire, right? This inflammation that occurs through the system. For some things, like a rash or a little bit of joint pain and rash, you can put out the fire with an anti-malarial drug, like Plaquenil. So if the theory is use the least toxic drug possible, right, that would be the first approach. If that alone doesn't do it, you say, okay, well, I guess I probably need to use a little bit of cortisone, prednisone, to help put out the fire, and then maybe this drug will hold it, right? So you may introduce a little bit of prednisone. Again, remember, nowadays, we're trying to use as little and as short a time as possible for prednisone. Now, it's at that phase, if you're not responding, that we go on to those immunosuppressive or cytotoxic drugs. And then you say, well, which one, right? So there was a time, when I was a year or two younger, that people were using cyclophosphamide a lot, right? This is a drug which worked, but it had a significant side effect. In young women, it promoted infertility. So we tried not to use that drug. And so now it's gone down from number one to maybe number three or four, right? The other drugs, like Imuran or Celcept or methotrexate, usually it depends on the manifestation. If you have arthritis, you might get methotrexate. If you have skin or kidney, probably you might get Imuran or Celcept. So it's one of those drugs now that are used if the first two have failed. And then you watch patients, you try to get a remission, and then you start nibbling away at the drugs. Now let me make one other point. If you get a remission, and if you're in remission, I mean things are quiet, then you'll likely be on no or very little prednisone. And you will be on Plaquenil, hopefully. And you may be on one of those other drugs like Celcept. And you've been in remission. So when do you start taking away the medicine? Right? So that's not quite so clear, but we've done some early studies. And in patients who are in remission, and if you take the drug away, overall, about 50% flare within 2 years. However, if you've stayed on the drug for a period of time, like 1 to 2 years, before you take it away, in other words, where you're allowing the drug to really put this out, right, you're much less likely to flare, right? And if you have been on very little prednisone when you start taking the drugs away, you're much less likely to flare. So get a remission, keep the remission for a period of time, and then start nibbling away at the medicines. Yes?
What exactly does remission mean? Are you having no symptoms whatsoever?
Yes. Okay. So for remission, it means, well, I shouldn't say symptoms. There are a lot of reasons to have symptoms. Symptoms due to lupus.
Okay.
Now, you know that a lot of patients with lupus will have what's called fibromyalgia.
Mm-hmm.
So for the more senior in the audience, that's what our parents used to call rheumatism, you know? So it's not arthritis. The joint isn't inflamed, but you're achy and stiff all over. That's not due to active lupus. That's due to the fact that you have a significant problem, and you know, it's sleeping properly, or there are a lot of other reasons for causing fibromyalgia. So that's not lupus, right?
Okay.
You could have that and still be in remission.
Okay.
Remission means you have no rash, you have no arthritis, you have no pleurisy. You're good.
That's your lungs. Right?
That's inflammation of lungs. You got pain when you breathe and things like that, or pain in your heart when you lean forward or you breathe, etc. So remission means all that goes away.
Okay.
Now, your blood test may still be positive. But that doesn't matter. Remission is when you, when everything clinically is gone,
mm-hmm.
right? And that's when you say, okay, it's gone. I'm probably going to wait a year to two. And, you know, the patients will say, oh, let's just wait a year. And the doctor will say, well, can we stretch it out a bit? You know, and then you come to a compromise somewhere between 1 and 2 years. And if you're still well at that point, we start nibbling away at the medicine. Yes?
Do most lupus patients get FM?
Somewhere between 20% and 40%, depending on which, you know, the series you read. So it's pretty common. And the major cause of fibromyalgia in lupus patients, two major causes. One, you don't sleep normally.
Yeah.
Abnormal sleep will give you fibromyalgia, whether you have lupus or not, right? So that sleep means, Ann and I were just listening to lectures on sleep, but sleep means 6 to 8 hours of deep sleep, stage 4 or REM sleep.
Mm-hmm.
How many get that? I don't think I've ever had it. So that's ideal. But, you know, so the more sleep you get, the better. And that means good deep sleep. So when you wake up in the morning, after the first 10 minutes or so, you say, okay, I'm raring to go. If you have fibromyalgia and if you didn't sleep normally, you'll get up in the morning, and by noon you'll say, I'm ready to go. Right? So there's a big difference. So one is fibromyalgia is poor sleep. So do your sleep hygiene. The second thing is stress. Stress, and maybe the two are related. If you're stressed, you don't sleep well, right? But stress certainly contributes to fibromyalgia.
And how do you get tested for that?
Fibromyalgia is a clinical diagnosis. The doctor will be able to make that diagnosis.
Dr. Urowitz,
yes.
We have a question here.
Yes.
I'm just wondering, have you any studies or knowledge on the use of medical marijuana, cannabis oil, hemp oil? Sure helps people with cancer. Okay.
Okay, so let me make a generic statement here and no personal... It's very interesting. That's a very good question. Remember I told you to develop a new drug for all the studies that it requires $100 million.
Yeah.
Marijuana is legalized in Ontario, medical marijuana, no studies.
Interesting.
Nothing. A few oddball studies of a few patients here or there, nothing. So this is social pressure. That guy, if a drug company came up and said, I'm going to make marijuana, they'd be knocked off. You know? But this is available, right? So what can I tell you about marijuana? And I'm certainly no expert in that. I know that medical marijuana seems to help for pain. Would I use it for any of those inflammation parts of lupus? Absolutely not. Would I use it in somebody? Do people use it? Do people use it for the pain which is not due to lupus but due to fibromyalgia or something like that?
Yeah.
They are using it for that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, I know in Ontario, for instance, there are many physicians who won't prescribe it because they say, I don't know what to look for in terms of side effects or anything, you know, long-term or short-term side effects. So generally, medical marijuana is prescribed by a few physicians, but mostly in pain clinics, physicians who run pain clinics, where they have more experience with this drug. So beware, not to be used for the inflammation part of lupus, but for the other things, like the fibromyalgia pain and things like that, maybe there's a role. I don't know that. I don't know the studies, but it's certainly being used for that. Sorry. Yes?
I'd like to come
Stop
back
me anytime, by the way. Where's, okay?
May I come back to the Plaquenil for a moment?
Yes.
I know that it also has side effects. And in my case, I happen to know of a situation that were quite drastic side effects. Now, I noticed that when I went to my new rheumatologist, she was quick to recommend that. she really didn't know me, right? And she didn't know my history as well as, and I, that's my opinion, that she might have, right? And so when a person is considering these things, I'm wondering, how does one go about making those decisions? Because sometimes what happens when you're in crisis, you just go with whatever because you're kind of in a desperate situation.
Right.
But when you're not in that, you have some time to consider the best possibilities.
Right. So it's an important question. The issue is, what about Plaquenil? So let me make a blanket statement, not with respect to your case. Every lupus patient who can should take Plaquenil. The studies are incontrovertible. And the studies showing that it prevents relapses is a Canadian study, actually. And it's followed all around the world. So if you can take it, you should take it. When you first appear, virtually everybody can take it, unless they have an eye situation, a different eye situation, which might make the detection of Plaquenil side effects difficult. Okay? So if someone has macular degeneration or some other condition, retinitis pigmentosa, something wrong with their retina, the doctor may say, gee, if you get toxicity from Plaquenil, which the main toxicity is the eye toxicity, if you get it, it might be hard to differentiate, therefore maybe it's not a good drug for you. That is unbelievably rare, right? So what is the issue then? Therefore, virtually everybody should be able to take it. Then how do you monitor that? So if you have an eye examination every 6 to 12 months, right, they know exactly what to look for. You can pick up early toxicity very easily. And if you go regularly and they pick up early toxicity, it doesn't advance.
But there was another part to that, that. So they determine there's a concern and they let you know that. But then the warning is that if you go off of it, like you were saying, the longer you're on it, the longer the body has a way of making use of it and making it work for the long term. But it's kind of frightening when you think that you're going to be on this, and if for some reason or other you did have those adverse side effects, then you would flare. That's a frightening thing in itself.
Yeah, but if there are no side effects seen in the eye, it's quite safe to stay on it. You know, it's only when you see something in the eye, then you should come off. And if you come off with very early findings, that it won't progress to any significant findings.
Well, the only other thought on that was the amount. Could you talk about that?
Yeah, sure. So the Plaquenil is taken based on body weight. So we calculate it as between 6 and 6.5 milligrams of Plaquenil for every kilogram of body weight. 6 milligrams per kilogram. All right? But we never go beyond 400 milligrams. Now, you'd have to be pretty big to go beyond, you know, if it's 6 milligrams per kilogram, you'd have to weigh about 65 or 68 kilograms, be 150, almost 150 pounds. So once you're 150 pounds, you don't go higher on the Plaquenil. Maximum is 400, but if you're less than that, you calculate it at 6 milligrams per kilogram, okay? Now, that's the drug, that's the dose that we think is important to induce a remission, to help you get a remission. Now, what if you've been on Plaquenil for 4 or 5 years and you've been in remission for 3 or 4 years? There's a legitimate question to say, well, do I need the same amount to maintain this remission? Now, for this, now hear this carefully, there are no studies. But what's the practice? Generally, the practice is to lower the dose somewhat. You know, if you're in remission and have been in remission for a period of time, a couple of years, you say, well, maybe you don't need 6 milligrams per kilogram, maybe 5 or 4 would be enough, right? But remember, that's standard of practice out there, now it's what's happening, but there are no studies, okay? I've had people on Plaquenil for 25 years, 25 to 28 years. Yes?
Scleroderma is a cousin to lupus.
Yes, it is.
Lots of people with lupus have scleroderma. And I
Not lots, some.
Okay. And I don't know if this is a personal question, it applies to everybody, but is there a correlation between the drugs used for lupus and the drugs used for scleroderma?
So, very good question again, and I'm not answering you specifically. With lupus, it's one of these autoimmune diseases like we've been talking about. You don't make antibodies against your own tissues. And so they are cousins because they're both autoimmune diseases. In lupus, you have, on rare occasions, what's called an overlap syndrome. In other words, you have lupus, you have all the antibodies, etc., that diagnose lupus, but you have some of the clinical features of scleroderma, right? Those patients respond well to the same treatments as lupus does. Okay? If they have scleroderma alone, the treatment's different. Right? But in the overlaps, you know, where you have a little bit of scleroderma but you clearly have lupus, the treatment is the treatment for lupus.
If you have clearly scleroderma and a little bit of lupus, is it the same thing?
No, I think that doesn't happen very often. You know, the pure scleroderma patients really don't have a lot of lupus. But a few lupus patients have a definite overlap with scleroderma.
We're just wondering if it's connective tissue disease. Does it apply the same, exactly the same way? Like, you know, MS, lupus,
I don't know. Yeah, so MS is not part of mixed connective tissue disease, but mixed connective tissue disease is a condition where you have some features of lupus, some features of rheumatoid arthritis, and some features of scleroderma. And the doctor says, what's happening here, right? And this is all, there are features of all three coming together. There's even a blood test that occurs in these people, a common blood test. So you say, what happens to them? So what happens to these people is one of three things. They either stay like that forever. Mix kind of a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and respond to treatment, and it's not a big thing. Some of them start out like that and then become scleroderma a year or two later and say, oh, that was the beginning and now it's scleroderma. And some of them, after a year or two, become clear lupus. So this is almost like a condition looking for an identity. Some never find the identity, always stay mixed up. And some become lupus, some become scleroderma. And you treat accordingly.
I'm just curious, if you take one of these drugs that slow down your B cells, would that make you more susceptible to other things?
Good for you. So remember we said that that's the same story with the first drugs that we're all using. When you blast all drugs, like with Imuran or Cellcept, you knock out all the cells, right? So you're hoping that you're knocking out only the bad cells that are making the bad antibody, but you're not only doing that. You are knocking out some of the good cells. So one of the major side effects of those treatments is infection. So you have to be very careful. So the doctor has to be careful of watching carefully and treating you early. And you have to be careful not to expose yourself, to make sure you get the flu shot. You know, in other words, protect yourself against infection as much as possible. These drugs will probably be exactly the same. Even though they're only tickling the immune system, not really killing the cells, you know, but modifying them slightly, you never can be sure that you're only getting, you're tickling out the bad ones and leaving all the good ones. That would be the best treatment. But it's not always possible. So susceptibility to infection is always there, and we have to be, you have, doctors and the patients have to be very careful in protecting against infection. Okay.
Well, everyone, please join me in thanking Dr. Urowitz for attending.